God. You know, we want to take things in our own hands. That seems the hardest thing for us to do,
yes,
is to wait.
Yes.
You know, following God, doing what he wants us to do, saying what he wants us to say, and going where he wants us to go, sometimes that can be kind of frightening. I can remember when Pastor McGill and I was coming to Georgia, and I said, no, I ain't going to Georgia. You know, I ain't going. So he didn't argue with me. He didn't change his mind. He kept preparing to go to Georgia. I said, now, why does this man keep on getting ready to go to Georgia? And I told him I ain't going. So he didn't let that bother him. So I started to pray about it, you know. So I kept praying about it. And each time I prayed, all the things the Lord would give me is that I got to follow him, you know. So finally I gave in. And I said, well, I guess I'm going to Georgia. But I remember we had started to Georgia in our car, and the car broke down before we got to Georgia. I said, see, that's a sign. Right there, that's a sign that we ain't supposed to be going. He didn't let that bother him. He came right on back. We got a ride back home, and he went to his daddy and got his Bronco. We got the Bronco. We had one windshield wiper. And it started to rain before we got to Georgia. I saw all these signs, and he's still trying to get to Georgia. We didn't have no reverse in the Bronco. So he said that was a sign that we wasn't going back.
All right.
So however, I came on to Georgia, and here I am today. I'm still in Georgia. So we have to just wait, and we have to be patient, you know, and we have to listen to God. And most of all, my husband is saved, you know, we got to follow him. You know, if he makes the mistakes, I've learned it's on him, not on me. And God don't want us to be afraid, you know, to do, when he tells us that he wants to do something, he wants to do that. He don't want us to be afraid. He told Abraham not to be afraid.
Amen.
He said, I am your shield and exceedingly great reward. So right there, he was letting Abraham know that he's going to protect him. Also, he was rewarding Abraham. But through it all, Sarah and Abraham wanted to have children. But back in the story, you notice God told Abraham that he was going to make him a great nation. And he was going to make his name great, you know. But they didn't have any kids. You know, they had waited and waited, you know, still didn't have any kids. They were in the out there in the wilderness. So God told Abraham to leave his kindred, leave that land, and go to Canaan. But during that time, he didn't do exactly what God said to do, because he told him to leave his kindred. And he took some along with him. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes we have to get kinfolk back.
All right.
All right. All right. All right. Amen.
You can't take kinfolk with us all the time.
Amen.
But however, that's what he did. And so, like I'm saying, he had already told Abraham he's going to make his name great, you know. So, Sarah's looking at it, well, Abraham is 85 years old. She's 75. They want children, but they still don't have any children. So Sarah starts to doubt God.
Yes.
How many of us do that?
Amen, God.
You know, we doubt God.
Yes, God.
We think we have faith, but there's still that little bit of doubt.
Yeah.
That little bit of doubt there, you know. We just can't go all the way, you know. We have that little bit of doubt. So that's what Sarah was doing. So I should begin to think, well, you know, maybe he don't intend for her to have no children. You know? Maybe he intends for her to use her handmaid. Because back in those days, you could use the handmaid. And it was legal for her to let the handmaid have children. But, and after the children were born, they would belong to Sarah. So that's what Sarah thought, you know. So she went on and she suggested this to Abraham, you know, that maybe God wants them to use their handmaid, you know. But, you know, the Bible tells us two shall become one, not three.
All right.
Well.
All right.
So that was a mistake right there at that time. But however,
Sarah being 75 years old,
they wasn't looking at the promise that God told them. They was looking at, they wanted a child. That's how Sarah could see, but she wanted a child. So she finally went on to Abraham. He gave in to Sarah, even after God's telling Abraham what he was going to do for him. Abraham didn't listen. He listened to Sarah and went along with what Sarah said. You know, so she's thinking that she don't have any kids, she's barren, you know, so they done left Canaan, and they've been gone for 10 years, and they still don't have no children. She still ain't got three. You know, so this is when she decided what she's going to do. So through this, I found out, when you have prayed, and you have prayed, and you have prayed about a thing, and nothing happens, then we want to tend to help God out.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
God, I'm going to give you a little help.
Yeah.
I'm going to work on this thing with you. I'm going to give you a little help. You know, God works good, but God, you're too slow. I'm going to give you a little help, you know.
All right. All right.
Work this thing out for you. But faith and patience go together. Those things go together. We have to trust God. We have to trust God not only for his plan, but we have to trust him for his time and all.
All right.
Now this time is not going to be our time. So Sarah, she leaned it on this human understanding thing, not what God was saying, what we would say or what we would think, you know. So she had blamed God for not having any children. And so she let Abraham go into Hagar, her maid. So Abraham went into Hagar. And you remember, when we're walking by sight and not by faith, we're going to go wrong.
All right.
The Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. So remember that when we walk by sight, you know, what we can see, we're going to go wrong somewhere. So after Sarah got impatient after all these 10 years and everything went by, she finally, okay, Abraham going into Hagar. So he went into Hagar. Hagar found out she's pregnant. She got pregnant, man. So she's carrying her. She got the baby now. Now she's fine, Sarah, you know. You know how we can get something. You know. But then the word, you know, But anyway, old Sarah had to crack down on this stuff, you know. Hagar disrespected her and doing all this stuff, so Sarah got to put a handle on this stuff. She said, you, it's like, you know, today, like, you don't know me, sister. I'm in charge, ain't you? You don't know me. So you got to go. All right, she ran her off. You know, she ran Hagar off. But don't you know, by running her off, the problem didn't change.
Amen.
The problem is still there. You know, sometimes we do things and we try to get away from it, but the problem is still there. I can remember that long time ago, years ago, when we was out there partying in the world and something goes wrong, you get upset, you break up with your boyfriend or whatever, you know, you want to drink. You know, or something go wrong, you start drinking, thinking that's going to take the problem. But when you get sober, the problem's still there. You know?
Amen.
You got to drink some more. Mm-hmm. You know? And you still got the problem. And then you got a hangover. Mm-hmm. So you got two problems. But anyway, the angel of the Lord met Hagar. And he wanted to know what was going on. And so after Hagar explaining this stuff to him, well, he told her to go back. He told Hagar to go back. And also, Hagar, you got to work on your attitude. You know, you got to work on that attitude. But we think, why would God send her back into this situation? I don't know if Sarah was working on steps or Sarah was trying to jump off or what Sarah was doing to her, but it was a bad situation. So why? We should thank God we won't send her back into that same situation when he was going to only kick her out again. Mm-hmm. He was going to kick her out again. Sometimes God is the same, and he don't go the way that we think he should go to bring us back to work to show us what he's trying to do. Mm-hmm. And we may think that's harsh or think it's wrong, but sometimes that's how he do things. But God also, he wanted Ishmael to be raised there with in that home because he know that was a godly home, and he wanted Ishmael to be raised of God, you know, to be taught the things of God, you know, do things God's way. So that was one reason why he wanted him raised up that way. He wanted him to have a godly upbringing. And he wanted him to grow up to be a godly man. So Hagar, she does what it's so difficult for her. She goes back and she submits herself and she humbles herself. So you know, sometimes that's hard. You know, we go back and we have to humble ourselves down and submit ourselves. We don't want to do that, you know.
Amen.
We want things to go our way. Amen. Even with our husbands and things like that, you know. We don't want to be submissive sometimes. You know, we don't want to do what's right. And then we want things to go our way.
Amen.
But it doesn't work that way, you know. If I used to say, my daughter used to tell me, well, Mom, you married him, you got to be submissive to him. I said, you go home to your house.
All right.
You be submissive. You don't tell me how to be in my house. I said, that's because he want to eat peas and I want to eat butter beans. I mean, I got to eat peas too. So, but I found out I came a long way, you know. I had to learn to be submissive. I was so used to paying my own bills, doing everything around my own house. I remember one time I had told Pastor Nate Miller that it was time for gas bill. So he didn't say nothing about it, you know. So I'm used to paying my bills, no going on paying. I won't turn nothing off. So he never did say nothing. So I'm mad. I went on and paid the bill myself. So I said, I told you that the bill you're paying, you still, he said, I paid it. I said, you paid the gas bill? He said, yeah. I said, I would have paid it too. He said, well, that's you. Yeah, I couldn't get my money back. So,
added it to me.
You have to be patient. And you have to listen. And I want to say to some of our young people, you know, when you want a husband, rather, you got to be patient. Wait on God. Because the devil put a suit on a jumper, put a Bible in his hand, and you just wait. what you want.
What you say?
Yes, Lord.
You gotta wait. You gotta pray. You gotta wait on God. You know, you gotta wait on. I said many times when Pastor McMillan and I got together, I said I was praying for a husband. I wanted a husband. I was praying for a husband. And when we got together, he was playing at the church that I went to. And I had left that church. I hadn't saw him for about a year. And I went to, I was supposed to be going to Shoney's one night. I ended up at Kentucky Fried, and there he was. At Kentucky Fried. We got to start talking and stuff. So however we got together. So I knew things was working out for us. And I said, Lord, he ain't the one. It ain't him. I said, first of all, I eat real skinny. I ain't like no skinny man. I mean, he was skinny. Then I knew I was older than he was. I never liked no young man, you know. And I'm like, no, I know he thinks of him. It was, you know. When I told my daughter, she said, well, did you pray for her? Did you specify exactly what you wanted? And I said, well, no. She said, well, God gave me what you asked for. You want a Christian man, you want a good man, that's what you got. So however it worked out, I love it. So it worked out. But I'll tell you, young people, wait on God. Don't get impatient. You know, you have time. Wait on him. And like our pastor was saying this morning, young girls having babies, you know, I had a baby when I was young, I had a lot of problems behind. Every young girl can have babies come out good behind. I had a lot of problems behind having a baby. But just pray. Keep yourself in church and listen to the pastor and just pray. Wait on it. You know, you can wait. You can. You can do it. But getting back to Sarah and Abraham, they did Hagar wrong, but then they came to the conclusion, all of them straightened out. They did it wrong, but they suffered for it also. So when you do somebody wrong, you're going to get your payback. It's coming back to you. Somehow, some way, it's going to come back to you.
Amen.
When you do people wrong. But God stepped in, and he cared for all of them. Sarah, Hagar, Ishmael. If Sarah and Abraham had waited on God, they could have avoided a lot of pain. A lot of pain. But they got ahead of God because they thought God was too slow. And they didn't want to wait. So God, he shows us through his ability that he can work out all things for the good if we let.
Amen.
If we wait on and we let, he can work it out. Abraham and Sarah, they finally received the son that they so desperately wanted. He gave them that son. And when God was telling Abraham he was going to make him a great nation, he should have listened then and knew that God was going to work in his favor. But sometimes we don't listen. So we have to remember no problem. It's too complicated for God. No problem. It's not too complicated for God. The hard thing about it is us waiting. We can just wait on him. But we are too willing to help him out. God don't need no help. He don't need no help. He can do it all by himself. But that's the hardest thing for us to do is wait. Whether we're expecting something good, bad, or whatever it is, the hardest thing to do is wait. Our timing is not God's timing. Our thoughts are not his thoughts. So if we just wait, we just wait on him. I read a little thing about this man. He was praying about the mountain because every morning he got up, he looked out his window, a big mountain was blocking everything. He couldn't see. So he said, well, I'm going to pray about it. I'm going to go to God about it. I'm just going to pray about it. So that night, he went to bed, he prayed about it. The next morning he got up, the mountain was still there. He said, that's just what I thought. If you know, if you think, why pray about it? We have to pray, live with God, but we have to be also in his will. We have So if we could just wait on God and quit getting ahead of God, thinking that God needs some help, God don't need no help.
Amen.
He don't need it. So young people, get that in mind. Sometimes we have to have that in mind also, that we got to wait on God. Anything we do, we got to wait on God. That's my message.